Well, our fans have been asking for this project, the Larry and Lee, Lee Ritenour, Larry Carlton project. For many years, each of us, without knowing it, would get fan mail saying, I'd love to see you play with Lee Ritenour or vice versa. But I was on MCA Records. Lee's been on GRP for many, many, many years. And finally, 1991, the two labels got together, which meant that Lee and I were now and then label mates. So one of the first things the president of the company said to me as I joined with GRP was, someday you and Lee have to do a record. So it's been coming for years and years and years.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it was 91 when GRP and MCA merged. And ever since then, you know, they said, will you guys do a record together? And I think we were both open to it. But initially, Larry had to start a solo album. And I think at the time, I was actually renegotiating and doing Foreplay. And then... but finally, we got it all right. So you know, last year we did the album. The sound of the new record with Larry and I is really a combination of elements. I think some songs are smoother than some of the maybe some of Larry's projects, and at the same time more textured than my projects. And we really tried to keep the album fresh with the guitar sounds. If I played the Gibson L5, the jazz guitar, Larry would play his Fender Strat or his Gibson Les Paul, and we would complement each other. And we were always trying to just keep the freshness and the variety of the sound.
And when making this CD with Lee, we know who our audience is. And we both know, it was unspoken, but we know what they want to hear from us. Besides a great performance, there's a certain kind of song that our audience expects to hear on radio, and then when they go buy the CD. So the album is very smooth, smoother than I would like to continue making my own personal projects, because I'm getting a little more aggressive and a little more passionate about the blues every year. Mm-hmm. But it's fun to move over and do that, knowing how much they're going to enjoy it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. The name of the first song on the album is called Crosstown Kids, and that alludes to the fact that Larry and I lived kind of crosstown from each other, very, you know, close. And it's a tune that I wrote, specifically we wrote all the tunes for the record. Mm-hmm. And he was writing for me, I was writing for him, and with the two guitars in mind. And Larry has worked a lot with Steely Dan, I have a little bit. And so I thought it would be fun to kind of have a song a little bit in that flavor. So that's where that song comes from.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Larry Carlton and Lee Ritenour.
Thank you. Konbanwa! Dōmo arigato! Hello, Tokyo! Saturday night in Tokyo. Please let me welcome my friend, Larry Carlton. And of course, Mr. Lee Ritenour. Thank you.
Jazz fusion, man. Back in the 70s, I was just a youngster, and Lee's 4 years younger than I am. I was fortunate enough to play with the Crusaders. And they had that funk, fusion, bebop, R&B kind of thing going, and then this little white guy from Torrance, California came in and started playing this sweet sound on top of it. We actually created a new sound in the fusion, quote, market, and it became so popular. Prior to that, it had been, I think, McLaughlin,
right.
Coryell, those guys.
Exactly.
So as I look back on the 70s, the term fusion was stuck on anything that they didn't know what else to call it, because music was evolving and changing back then.
Right. Yeah, the elements that were being contributed, especially by players like Larry and I in Los Angeles, you know, because I was with a whole other crowd. I was with Dave Grusin, and Larry Rosen was an engineer at the time, and they were producing Earl Klugh's first album, which again, that softer sound was coming, and then Dave and Larry produced my first couple of solo records, and then we were all playing at the Baked Potato together with Harvey Mason and Ernie Watts and Patrice Rushen and Anthony Jackson, and Al Jarreau would be at the Blah Blah Cafe, this other funny club, and he would come down, and then Larry started playing at the Baked Potato in and around the same time, and the kids would line up at 5 p.m. to hear us play at 10 p.m. So they would wait 4 or 5 hours, sometimes, you know, in the middle of winter and raining, and they would just be out there in order to get into that club, because a lot of the cutting edge of contemporary jazz in Los Angeles was being heard at that club.
It was being developed, and we didn't even know we were developing it. We were just playing the kind of music that we liked and finding this new avenue, and it actually set the standard for about the next 20 years as to where music was headed.
Feature the new album, a song that Larry and I wrote. This is called Low Steppin'. Thank you. Okay? I think it's all right. This next song is another new tune from the album, and it's a song that I composed, and we dedicated to the late, great Joe Pass. It's called Remembering JP. Thank you. Larry Carlton. And on the bass, Little Melvin Davis. Take your hat off, Al.
Well, we grew up really very close to each other in what's called the sort of the South Bay of Los Angeles. It's somewhat close to the beach. And I think I was about 14 and maybe Larry was about 18. And we used to go to this music store that was called Mr. B's for Music, right? And I think I might have heard you play the first time at that store. You might have been jamming at some little event at the store. And I said, wow, that guy's great, you know? And and then we'd run into each other, but we never really got to know each other, never really got to play, you know? And we were kind of on similar but different paths all those years.
When I first heard about Lee, it was probably mid-70s, I would think. I had been doing session work since 1970. About the mid-70s, I heard about this new guy who was coming into town, who was starting to do sessions. His name was Lee Ritenour, but we actually didn't meet. I think we only did one session together. And right after that, I had burned out on sessions, so I discontinued doing it. So Lee was really a name to me without a face or without an identity until about the mid-70s, and I think we ran into each other once or twice at the Baked Potato socially.
To say hello.
Say hello, and just happened to be there that night. But there was a definite vibe in the L.A. studio scene that I was in the middle of it, and there was this new guy coming in who could also cover and do a lot of things. So I knew there was a good player coming up.
going to turn the stage over to Mr. Larry Carlton.
I admire about Larry's playing, that's easy. You know, he has this great feel and texture to his sound. He has a lot of dynamics when he plays. He draws a lot out of the instrument and a very identifiable sound. You know, I think that's the most important thing for guitarists these days, or any instrument, but guitar is a hard instrument to get your identity on, and Larry's always had the Larry Carlton sound, you know, so that's always, it's been a stamp of his for 20 years, you know, and you know, just the way he improvises and combines blues and rock and jazz and stuff. I love all that different ways he can combine elements. When I hear him play the blues in concert, you know, I hear this authentic blues playing, but also I hear him drawing from jazz and from some of his rock and roll, of course, which is blues oriented. But it's always fun to play on the road with him.
I thought we played the blues. I'm sorry. I feel better now. One more lonely night in Tokyo. Okay, smiles and smiles to go.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Now, please welcome Mr. Lee Ritenour.
We'd like to turn to a little dedication to the great jazz guitarist, Wes Montgomery. This is from my Westbound album a couple years back. It's the title tune. Here we go, Westbound. Thank you.
Well, I admire Lee's playing. His technical facility is more than he will ever need. So he can draw on that at any time, no matter what kind of music he's playing. And his touch on the gut string guitar, the beauty with which he can get out of that instrument, I'm not the first person to respond to that. Back in the days of doing session work, I was the young guy who could read music and play with the rock and roll pop kind of feel. Lee was that young guy who could read music and go in and sound like the beauty on the gut string for the movie soundtracks and interpret and bring all that together. So that's definitely something I would look up to Lee about. Thank you.
Welcome back, Mr. Larry Carlton. Come on, I got two.
Thank you.
Well, it's interesting being a musician today. I think actually the key to being in the music business for a long term, meaning, you know, I respect those musicians who have been musicians for 50 years, you know. It's like when you see B.B. King and he's just been hitting it with that kind of consistency for all those years, it really makes a difference. And the younger musicians today, the versatile ones that also have a very strong identity of where they want to go, but the ability to do different things. It's like a movie director who you know, can make different kinds of movie, or an actor who can, Dustin Hoffman, who can be in so many different kinds of movies and yet still be Dustin Hoffman. You know, mm-hmm. that's what I look up to. You know, so whether it's producing another artist or composing or arranging or orchestrating or putting together big events like I've done here in Japan, Earth Voice or those kinds of events, I love that kind of variety. I always try to be Lee Ritenour in the middle of all that, but you know, that's it. It also keeps you fresh. You know, like doing this album with Larry, it's fresh. You know, it's something we should have done, and we did.
You know, having been a guitar player now for 41 years, ooh, I've had a chance to experience a lot of the different things in the studio and in the music community, and really decide what I like to do and what I don't like to do. I've produced a number of records besides for myself. I've arranged records from Barbara Streisand, Joan Baez. I've gotten to play with some of the great people. And I honestly can say I do not want to be a producer. I don't want to be an arranger. I really enjoy playing my guitar about 6 or 7 months out of the year and taking the rest of the time off from the music business. So you could say I'm not a workaholic and I'm not highly motivated except when my guitar is in my hand.
It's a great balance. Mm-hmm. It keeps you fresh sometimes to be able to take those breaks.
Thank you.
Please welcome Mr. Land Richards on the drums. The Yankee Man. From Houston, Texas, Land Richards. And also, mean B3 organ playing Rick Jackson. And once again, Little Melvin Davis. Thank you so much.
Well, I'm pretty much a music junkie. You know, it's a thing that I've always paid a lot of respect to the fact that we got to be musicians. You know, I think it's a very special gift to be able to do music your whole life. So I don't take it lightly, and I wouldn't leave it lightly. So I think the schedule that I lead right now is very hectic, especially the last half dozen years. It's been almost nonstop with one thing or the other, and I don't mind that. I like to work, but I'll look forward to that day years later when it slows down a little bit. But yeah, I think I'll be out on that old tour with my old buddies, you know. Probably Carlton and I will be doing that fifth reunion album, you know, and we're in our 65 and over crowd.
I'm a guitar player. I plan on playing the guitar until no one wants to invite me and listen anymore. I have so much respect, as Lee said, for B.B. King, Chet Atkins. These guys that love and have made music that people have responded to for so many years, I pray that people will continue to respond to my guitar playing so that I can give that back to them and share it with them until I die.
Because we also know, we've talked about it one time, where we know a lot of players who were very hot when they were in their 20s. And, you know, this happens especially with rock and roll bands and pop artists and then also musicians, guitar players, drummers, bass players. And they had maybe one special thing that they did, and they were able to do it while either that kind of music was popular or their particular little emphasis that they had was popular. And then after that, all of a sudden, they're out of the music business, and they're, they have a cleaning business or something now, you know, cleaning carpets or something.
It's usually not by choice either.
No.
It's as I had just said, people stopped responding.
Right.
To what they were doing. Yeah. So we're very fortunate for the amount of years that we've had and the amount I think we're going to have. Thank you. Putting time into your instrument is how you discover whether you have a special gift or not for music. Mm. You won't know until you've spent a lot of hours, a lot of days, a lot of months, a lot of years developing the basic skills to see if there's a gift inside of you that can come out. It's like learning to handwrite. Until you know the alphabet, you can't make up poems. So for the young players, I always tell them, spend a lot of time playing the music you like. If you're going to practice scales, do that for a while, but then move over and make some music that you like. And eventually you'll be able to see whether you have that special gift that calls you a musician or not.
What Larry says is right on the money. And I think when you're young, you have less distractions in life. You have less pressures in life. You know, I've run into a lot of young musicians where they wanted to develop their thing, and they started sort of late, maybe while they were in high school, and by the time they got into their 20s, maybe they were married and they had a child, and all of a sudden they had to get a real job, you know. And I think the parents, if their kids are excited by music and encouraged by music, then they should encourage them and try to help them and find a way to channel that creativity, and the better and the more a young student can learn when he's young, the better he's going to be, you know, because as you get older, the harder it gets.
Mm. Thank you.
Melvin Davis on the bass, Land Richards on the drums, Rick Jackson on the keys, my man, Larry Carlton.
Thank you so much. One more time, Mr. Lee Ritenour. Thank you very much.
Great audience, thank you.